Hello and welcome back to another episode at Nova Rice Invest. So today we have a very special episode. I've received a lot of excellent feedback. A lot of people were very content about the updates about the market on when not to buy. So today's episode will be all about when will be the right time to buy and how you can actually prepare for that to maximize your money and to also take advantage of the greatest offers out there. So what we're going to do is to jump straight into what I've had prepared for you today. And for that, we're going to switch the screen and there you go. So how you can actually benefit from the upcoming downturn in real estate. And before we dive in into anything, what I want to do is just a bit of a recap for those who were unable to either watch the prior episode, or maybe they watched it, but they just simply, you know, wouldn't hurt getting another recap. So last week, when I released the episode about reasons why not to buy, I talked about the combination that actually is leading to the increase in property prices and how that impacts your investment and why you shouldn't give in to your emotions and buy into that at a loss, right? So one of those combinations that I talked about is the high demand added with low supply. And in addition to that, cheap money. And for those who don't know what cheap money is, it's just basically has to do with the interest rates, right? Where you're borrowing money at a very ridiculously cheap low rates that it's almost like known as sixteen. And that makes money really cheap. So all those three items combined all together create the inflated prices that we're seeing nowadays. We have a low supply, and that means that whenever the properties are hitting the market, they are already hitting the market at a really high premium. That coupled with low supply, and I want to make an emphasis on low supply because that's what's leading to the bidding wars, right? There's very little housing available in the market, and everybody wants to get their hands on it because of that cheap money. And because of that, what it creates is a bidding war situation. And for those who don't know what that means, a bidding war simply just means the following. So you see a house and it costs $200,000. So you really want that house. You're giving into your emotions and you say, you know what? I want this home for my family, for myself, so we can grow all together. And because I don't want a chance losing that, what I'm going to do is just to bid $205,000 on a $200,000 home. And next thing you know, somebody comes in and finds out that you bid $205,000. So this person says, you know what? I'm going to do $210,000, right? Because I really want to get this house. And the next person bids $215,000, $220,000, $225,000, and you see where this is going. So that creates prices to go up even a lot more, in addition to the fact that they are already expensive as it is. And the third reason that I highly talked about, but I didn't cover in detail, and that's what I wanted to do today. Some of you have left comments, you know, the lack of understanding as to why is it that the property prices are going up? Shouldn't that be the opposite? I mean, after all, people are losing jobs anyways. So whoever asked that question, I'm going to clarify that today in this episode. This has nothing to do with the people who are actually losing their jobs. In fact, this has to do with people who still have their jobs and people with money and foreigners. So let's say, for example, there has been a big change in the migration pattern. So what's happening is that in big cities such as California, New York, which is highly dependent on, Silicon Valley, you call it Wall Street. These are people who normally have the flexibility to work from home. And now with everything that's happening with the pandemic and living in an overpriced area, a tiny little apartment, because you get to see those a lot in California and in New York, a lot of these families are actually wondering, okay, does it make sense to keep living here now that I can work basically from anywhere in the world? And if I can work from anywhere in the world, then why not get the most bang for my money, right? Why not just move from a state like California to Nevada, or from New York all the way down to Florida, where I can get more housing space, nicer weather for a fraction of the price that I'm already paying in here. So that's what's happening. So that's one type. Then the second group of people are rich people, people who are migrating their money from the big cities, the rich states, so to speak. So California, New York, New Hampshire, they're taking all of that money and they're parking it elsewhere. Why? Because they're realizing that, hey, property values are coming down in those areas. People are leaving their jobs. People are moving to different states. So I want to be where the action is because I want to keep protecting my money. And it makes sense, right? So what they're doing is they're taking all that money and they're investing it all in the southern states. Call it Florida, call it Arizona, Texas. Those are the states where you're seeing the biggest influx of people moving in and money flowing into that. And in addition to that, and this is something that people usually don't talk too much about, it's the influence of foreign money, right? We have a lot of foreigners who actually come into the United States to invest in real estate because of the fluctuations in their currency and because of the political turmoil in their countries. It makes it one way or the other safer to invest in the U.S. in spite of all the polarization that has been going on in politics lately, right? And to corroborate on that, what I want to do is just to share this nice article that I saw the other day, and it goes as follows. So U.S. foreign property investment statistics and facts, and it talks about the value of properties sold to foreign buyers. We're talking about $74 billion U.S. dollars, out of which 12% of this $74 billion comes from Chinese money, right? So we have a lot of Chinese people coming in and investing in real estate here. And they're not the only foreign buyers right here. If you look over here on the right, you will see that amongst those group of foreigners, we have, once again, the Chinese buyers at 12%. We also have the Canadian buyers right here at $9.5 billion U.S. dollars. We also have people from the U.K. and that represents a 2% of foreign investments. We also have people from India. We're talking about a 6% right here. And also people from Mexico at a 9%. So all of that combined with everything that's already going on. So the internal migration and also the foreign migration of money into this country. It's what's causing all of the housing prices to just basically boom and go up. So yes, some people have lost their jobs and we're going to get to that in a little bit, but that doesn't seem to have an effect on it because what it did was just a migration of investors. So instead of having the local people invest in real estate, we're getting foreign people to invest in real estate. And by foreign, I mean foreign from another state and also foreign from overseas. So that's one. Moving along with the presentation, I also talked about, you know, what goes up must go down, right? And we talked about the time frame as well. So we talked about different opinions that people had about when exactly will the housing market starts falling. So my realtor, for example, mentioned that she expects housing prices to go down somewhere around late December or January. I personally think that's going to happen around March because that's when the pandemic started. And some people out there, some colleagues are saying that they anticipate everything happening in June. Why? Because in June, that's when most people realize, okay, you know what? I think I cannot stay afloat a lot longer with my cash reserves, with what I have. Let me go ahead and ask for a forbearance. So that's a 12-month period. And for those who requested a forbearance back in March, then they're getting closer and closer to the end of the 12-month or the 18-month period, depending on their lender, to, you know, start making the payments again, plus interest. And what's interesting about all this dynamic, we talked about late December, January, March, and June. And at this point, we're in early December. And from what I've seen is that the prices have already started to drop, right? Literally, it has started to drop. And it's all a matter of you trying to figure out where, because you're obviously seeing the single family homes and they seem to be skyrocketing. But where exactly are the property prices coming down? And so for that, I have this article right here that I would love to share with you that was published in the Wall Street Journal. And this is a relatively new article, so to speak. It's not entirely new, but it's still applicable to everything what we're talking about. So the title goes as follows, malls file for bankruptcy and shut their doors as the pandemic pain spreads. So as you go along this article, they start talking about the changes in the market and how some of those changes were already happening, but COVID just came in and expedited. So one of the examples that they use in the article are companies like Neiman Marcus, Brooks Brothers, and JCPenney. They were on their way to bankruptcy because they were having a hard time attracting people to the stores, right? So now you might wonder, what does that have to do with anything? So everything in real estate, it's a ripple effect. It always starts somewhere. And then the fall of real estate is just basically a consequence of everything that has been piling up over time. So let's just think about this way, right? Neiman Marcus, they need customers. They need people coming into the stores and buying their products. That's how they pay their bills. And amongst those bills, it's the rent that they have to pay for the establishment that they're using. Now, if they don't get customers, they don't get money. They don't accumulate enough money to cover their bills, and therefore they don't pay the rent, which means the landlord is suffering as well, because now that landlord has a lender to pay to. But how can they pay the lender if they're not receiving money, rent money from their retail customers, from Neiman Marcus, from Brooks Brothers and JCPenney? And so this was something that was already happening because we live in a very digitized era. Everything is moving online. And once again, the pandemic just basically expedite that. So they didn't transition, or maybe they tried, but they couldn't. That's a topic for another day. But long story short, malls are closing, and that means companies like Neiman Marcus, Brooks Brothers and JCPenney are not getting any sales in. So that has a ripple effect on everything that is happening. And then on top of that, the story goes on and talks about other malls. Some of them are actually the Phoenix Metro Center Mall, Northgate Mall in Durham, North Carolina. So all of these malls are now underwater. If you compare the size of the mortgages versus their value 10 years ago, we're seeing history repeating itself with the properties in Florida. For those who invested in Florida, that saw that it took many years, over a decade, for properties to recuperate the value from back in 2008 and even exceed that. So that's the scenario that we're seeing right now. And there's another article right here. This one is actually a little bit older. It's from October 27, 2020, but one way or the other, it just corroborates, it complements the other article that I just shared with you. So lenders cracking down on mall owners behind their mortgage, right? So Saks at Miami Mall, Midtown Manhattan retail properties, they become foreclosure targets. Now, back to the presentation. We talked about what eventually goes up must go down, and the price is already dropping. Now, the key question is, what can you do to wait for everything to go down? You can't just sit there and wait. You have to do something, right? So let's say, assuming you have properties in those bull markets, remember, real estate is very localized, and not every single state is experiencing a bull market, right? So like I talked about, usually in the southern states, people from up north are taking their money and investing in the south. If you happen to have properties in those areas, what you can do is to either sell or refinance. And how do you know which one to pursue? So let's say, for example, you have a house, maybe you're not a big fan of it, but you were just simply holding on to it because now the next big opportunity is coming here, and this is your chance to get rid of it and use that money to buy something even bigger at a much better premium. Or let's say you have one of those properties, you have an excellent tenant, or maybe there's sentimental value in it and you don't want to get rid of it, right? So what you can do is just simply do a refinance, do a cash out refi, take the cash out of it and get that liquidity ready so you have money ready to buy when the right time comes. Now, I know a lot of you might probably be wondering, okay, but what do I do with all of that cash in the meantime? Because as you know, the banks are also not offering the best rates as possible. I definitely don't want to leave my money in the bank. So what else can I do? Well, one thing you can do while you wait is just shift your money from one asset to another. So you can take that cash and invest it in the stock market, or perhaps in precious metal, particularly gold or silver or both, or maybe in cryptos. And by crypto, I'm talking only about Bitcoins, nothing else. Now, and I have a big warning for you. Watch out. Because in order for you to invest in either of these type of assets, call it the stock market, precious metal, or crypto, you need to educate yourself. You can't just go in blindly. Not everything is investing material. And speaking of which, I know a couple of you had left me messages down in the comment section asking me if I could cover more in-depth topics that are related to the stock market. If you still want me to do that, please let me know in the comments box below. This is normally a real estate channel, but we're in the middle of unprecedented times, and this is the perfect timing for you to learn how to diversify your portfolio, and investing in the stock market, it's one way to help you diversify and then just move your money around what you weigh. So we'll definitely love to create more content related to that subject, but just please let me know in the comment section what exactly about the stock market would you like to learn. Now, moving along, if let's say, for example, you're a very busy person, you don't have time because, hey, this pandemic has taken you I don't know, by surprise. Maybe you have family members that you need to take care of and you just don't really have the time to learn about any of this stuff. Well, then you can find capital or look for ways to accumulate capital, looking for alternatives. And one alternative way to get access to all that money is by working with companies with Fund and Grow. Now, if you've never heard about Fund and Grow, or maybe you know a little bit of them, but you want to inquire more, I have an episode right here, somewhere up here, where you can click and you can learn all about them. And you will also get their contact information in the description box of that particular video. And for those who are curious and wondering, okay, what exactly is it before I even jump into that video? So, well, they're a company that specializes in helping their customer base to get access to commercial credit cards, commercial credit, commercial capital. Why is that so important? Well, because commercial capital does not appear in your personal profile. It appears on a business credit profile. So you can jack up the debt because of whatever circumstance. Maybe you need access to capital. You don't have to be afraid of, oh, I need to keep everything under 30%. Otherwise, my score is going to suffer a negative impact. You don't have to worry about that anymore. So it is definitely an excellent tool, a great way to allow you get access to capital. So feel free to reach out to them. Now, back to the presentation. The next thing you can do, it's monitor, monitor, monitor. I cannot emphasize that enough, but monitoring, it's a very important component of investments. Why? And it's not just real estate, isn't any type of investment, because you need to see the direction where things are heading. Same thing with the property houses. You need to know where is it going to continue to go up or when is it going to continue to come down. And it's something that doesn't happen overnight. You have to keep monitoring and see what happens. So let's say, for example, a couple of months ago, the same property that is now selling at 220, 210 was at 170, right? And then from 170 jumped to 180 and then jumped to 190 and so on all the way until it hit 230. But eventually, like I said, everything that goes up must come down and there will be a ceiling up there. There's going to be a maximum value and then there's going to be a reset in the market, and that's applicable across all type of investment assets across the board. So it is very important that you monitor that. And not only because of that, but also because real estate, it's very local. Like I said, for example, states like California and New York, they're experiencing a downturn versus other states in the South who are experiencing a massive growth because of the demand and the lack of supply and the excess money and also cheap money, right? Now, why you need to all of that? Once again, because you need to be ready. You need to be ready. You need to be able to identify when is the perfect timing to jump in and also have the capital to be able to invest at the perfect timing. So just to recap, your options are to either sell or refinance. And once you get access to all of that liquid cash, you can reinvest it in another asset in the meantime so it can continue to grow. And then when the time is right, then you can liquidate all of that and use that cash to invest. And if that doesn't work, you can work with companies like Fund and Grow. And once again, very important, keep monitoring, monitoring, and monitoring. Now, before we move on, if you're enjoying this episode, do not forget to hit the like button. But most importantly, if you find this episode useful, not just to you, but to also to your loved ones, please share the love and share this video with someone else. Let's help the NovaRise mission and helping others get access to financial literacy, to financial education at this time, because everybody deserves to have access to a better life. And this is one way to make that happen. So please share the love. And once again, don't forget to hit the like button down there. Now, moving on. Now that you know how to prepare for that time, let's talk about what can you expect to see within the next 6 months or so. Well, within the next 6 months, what we're going to see, it's an increase in supply of properties. Why? Because tenants will eventually stop paying the rent. And there's a certain categories that you need to pay attention to. So the first one, we already covered that earlier in this video, shopping centers, malls. Those are by default, by far, the ones that are going to start defaulting. And therefore, we're going to get more and more of that supply available in the market as banks start foreclosing on them. The second are properties that are highly dependent on entertainment or the shopping centers. So hotels are a great example of that. So hotels are located nearby stadiums. So let's say, for example, Times Square and Broadway shows, right? All of that has been shut down. So you can imagine what those hotels are currently going through. We have restaurants. Some of them are still closed and just working on delivery. Some of them are working at half capacity because of the restrictions and how many people you can sit in the restaurants. Clothing stores are not open opening up and everything has been digitized. And speaking of which, I want to make an emphasis on hotels here and why I think they are the next target to come down. So there's an article right here, also very interesting, that talks about the hotel business. So investors are seeing big profits and throwing a lifeline to hotel owners. So just to quickly recap, and feel free to look for this article and read it in your own time. But in essence, what this article is talking about, it's how the hotel business is trying to stay afloat, right? So as you know, highly dependent on entertainment, not a lot of people are actually traveling because of COVID. And on top of that, theaters are closed and everything that's related to that field, it's somewhat closed. So they're not getting any guests. So these hotels, they also have mortgages. And because they're not getting access to customer or guest money, guess what they have to do? They actually have to go to other lenders who are borrowing at a much higher rate just so they can take that money over here and have enough cash available to cover the mortgage over here on the other side. So if things don't get resolved with COVID, guess what's going to happen? Now they're going to have two loans to worry about. They're going to have a mortgage to worry about here, and they're going to have a very high interest loan to worry about it. That's a recipe for disaster. It's a very, very toxic combination, and something I definitely feel really bad for them that they are in that position right now. So now back to the presentation, right? So we're talking about properties, hotels, and then offices. I actually anticipate there could be a decay in office spaces, but that will be highly dependent on what happens with the COVID vaccine, right? And for those who need a little bit of help drawing the correlation, so let's just take a step back. Why do I say office spaces? So the lease with office spaces, they worked a little bit different than when the usual residential leases that we all know about. So residential leases usually can go for a year or two. That's on average how long they last. But anything that's commercial, office space related, retail space related, those leases could go for 5, 10, sometimes even 15 years. So you're locked in at a certain rent rate and you have to meet your obligations. So what's happening here is that, for example, there's another article right here that talks about what these offices are doing. Corporate tenants, they're dumping excess office space, sending shivers through the market. So a lot of these people, a lot of these corporate tenants, they don't have people working in their offices. That's a given, right? Most of them are actually working from home. So they need to figure out a way, okay, so how do we occupy the space right here? Because obviously no one is using it. So they are going through the sublease route in order to create some type of liquidity so they can cover the rent, right? So that's one thing. And because the rent leases are, you know, signed and they're locked in a contract for so long, they don't know whether they're truly going to make a good use of it or not. And that ties back to, once again, to the COVID vaccine. So if Pfizer or whatever company out there manages to create a vaccine within the next 6 months or the next 12 months, chances are these companies are most likely going to want to draw their workforce back into the office, or at least create a combination of both, some people in the office and vice versa, because they have all of these leases that, hey, they need to use up. So that's one. But if for whatever reason the vaccine turns out to be not successful, it doesn't roll out to the market, then we're looking at, you know, these big companies, corporate tenants, trying to figure it out, okay, a year has gone by, what can we do to resolve this issue? Because obviously, we don't know what's going to happen. There's no vaccine available and we can't bring people back in. So that's when potentially negotiations can start happening with those corporate landlords to figure out the best way to, you know, get a win-win situation as possible for everybody. So that's why on the office space field, it's somewhat of a 50-50. That's still more of a TBD. But the first two categories right here, shopping centers and hotels, let's say, have a higher likelihood of going down. Let's assume things went down and you had access to all these inventory and you lucked out, you were able to get your hands on this great, excellent premium. So now you're wondering, what can I do, right? What can I do to make things better and maximize my investment? Well, if you were able to get a hands on a single family homes, then you're pretty much set, because there's always going to be demands for single family homes. Everybody needs a roof over their head, right? So single family families and the funeral business are the only two businesses that will never go out of business, regardless of whether you're in a recession, a depression, because, hey, everybody, once again, need a roof over their head. And people always want to send their loved ones off properly after they are deceased, right? Second, if you get access to hotels, you can convert those and multifamilies. And you might probably wonder, why would I ever do that? But hold that thought, I will get there eventually. If you were able to get access to either hotels or office spaces, you can turn those into local storage. Once again, people could be coming back and the big houses that they bought out in the suburbs, Connecticut or whatever state you want to call it, now they have excess furniture, they have excess stuff that they're going to need to bring back into a storage facility and keep that because it's not so easy to get rid of it, right? At the same time, we live, once again, in a very digitized world. Now, big companies like Facebook and Amazon, they have a higher need to get more office space because, let's say, for example, companies like Amazon, who process thousands and thousands of orders on a daily basis, they need bigger warehouses, right? Otherwise, I mean, where else are they going to hold their inventory? And then in addition to that, the more and more people work from home, big companies and corporate companies are going to need access to data centers, the cloud, right? We're moved from an era where everything used to be print and we used to kill a lot of trees and stuff like that into now something that has been, you know, completely digitized. And now we have online signatures, everything is safe in the cloud, but even the cloud requires space. It requires a place to store the data, and that's what these offices can be used for. And for those who need a little bit of evidence, I also have another article right here to show you, and it talks about the big titans in the stock market. So we're talking about companies like Amazon, Google, or Facebook. They are the ones driving the commercial real estate. So we're seeing a decay in malls and shopping centers, and that is a fraction of commercial real estate falling, but then we have this other fraction of commercial real estate going up in value thanks to these big titans right here. So you were able to get your hands on either one of these, you were basically lucked out by being able to conduct business with these big corporations. And now tying back the local storage and the data centers into hotels converted to multifamilies, as you can see, people will probably have the need or the tendency to want to come back or need to come back to the city. So that's where the multifamilies come in quite handy. And even if they were not to come back, we still have the need for storage centers and data centers. And guess what? Guess who's behind that computer processing your order, packaging your order, putting the shipping label on it? Yes, there are some robots behind the scene, but for the most part, you still have humans. And that's the part I wanted to talk about regarding jobs, right? A lot of people were saying, oh, there's a lot of jobs losses in the market. There hasn't been a loss. It's just simply a shift from one thing to another. So people who used to be in the entertainment business are now working for companies like Amazon, doing deliveries for the seniors who can't just step down because of the virus, or just simply doing delivery, or they're probably working in the assembly line, packaging all of those boxes that you're probably ordering online right now. So there's been a shift. There's been a shift with people delivering groceries in general because less and less people are going to the supermarket, and now they rather order the groceries at home just because they don't want to get exposed to other people who may or may not have the COVID virus. So all of this ties in hand very nicely, right? Now, once again, remember that it's impossible to make a prediction, right? I wish I had a magic ball to say, hey, this is exactly what's going to happen. I can only make observations based on everything that I've seen, and the data sort of like corroborates that. But at the end of the day, it's impossible to know for sure what will happen. Only time will tell. And if there's any change in the market, I will definitely make sure that you are the first one to find out about any of those changes because I want to keep you posted. And while I still have you here, do not forget to check this episode right here that was released a couple of weeks ago that talked about why this is not really a good moment to buy. So that way it can help you complement everything that you're just learning today. So that's pretty much all I have for you. I will hopefully see you guys soon in the next episode. And until then, take care. Bye-bye.